So just a little bit of information about me. So I'm actually now a consulting app developer at HCA, primarily C# development, and I'm a member of the data innovation team, which is actually part of our integration team. And we're really focused on, I'm really focused on doing two things. The first is improving dev joy for internal development. How do we get the data through our platforms to internal development teams easier and faster for them? And the next is how do we use our data in new innovative ways to improve patient care and patient experience? So I've been at HCA for 3.5 years, and my primary focus is around design and implementation of the products that our team is working on. So a little bit of data about HCA. If you haven't heard about us, that's not uncommon, but we are one of the largest U.S. providers of health health services in the United States. We own just shy of 178 hospitals, and that's usually what we're well known for, but we actually also own 1,800 different sites of care, from surgery centers to freestanding ERs to urgent care centers and physician service groups. We see about 28.2 million patient encounters per year. 5% of all U.S. healthcare services actually occur inside of an HCA facility, which means if you're a developer at HCA, you have a huge impact on our healthcare industry in the United States just by working on projects there. And we see about 70 billion events that are going through our integration services per year. It's about 50 million that are going through every day through our systems. So we're using two WSO2 products for two specific problems that I'm going to talk about. So the first problem, we're using the API manager to correlate or to bring a bunch of different microservices together for developers. And then for our second problem, we're using the data analytics server to analyze healthcare data that's going through our platforms. So the first problem is, how do we make healthcare data fast, easy, and cheap to integrate with using today's web standards? And it's all about that developer joy for internal development teams. So elaborating on that problem a little bit more, integrating with healthcare systems is hard. So if you work in the healthcare industry, you probably know this. Typically, healthcare data is point-to-point connections over TCP. For instance, at HCA, we're managing 46,000 different point-to-point connections today through our team. And then the other thing is HL7 data. I'll show you what it looks like here in a second if you haven't seen it, but it requires a very unique knowledge and service experts whenever you're going to integrate with it to just pull basic information out of it. And then to make matters worse, there's some customization that can happen on top of it. So if you really don't know exactly how it's being implemented at a facility, then you're kind of in trouble. So the other issue is, how do we get developers the data they need? So typically, obviously, a real-time platform like this, it's hard to query data after the fact. So when an integration team integrates with us, they are responsible for receiving, you know, potentially millions of events going through a facility, and then filtering based on just the small subset of data that they need out of that. So how can we make that better for those developers? And that's the whole fire hose, not a faucet. We're sending you this huge fire hose instead of just the data you need. So this is what HL7 looks like. So it's all pipe delineated, carrots between different segments. So if you were a developer that was just starting without any healthcare experience, you'd probably look at this and go, wow, that's a complete nightmare for me to have to integrate with. So the HL7 organization has actually created a new standard that was an open collaboration with hundreds of different health organizations, and it's called FHIR. It stands for Fast Healthcare Interoperability Resources, and it takes a much more logical view of healthcare data. It breaks all the data up into what they call resources, which are small individual components. So like a patient would be a resource, and a location would be a resource. So all those different aspects are all broken down. It's all REST-based, so you know your normal post, put, get, delete. XML and JSON are your two primary ways to interact with it instead of just that terrible pipe delineated stuff before. On-demand access, so it's whenever you need data, however you're going to query it, you push in your search parameters and you do a get on it and you get back just the data you need. No need to store data as it's coming in and then do processing on it later. And it's an easy URL pattern, so it's what developers are used to. So you just go to, you know, FHIR/1.0.0/patient, ? Put in your search parameters, and there you go, you're going to receive your data you get back. So here's an example of what a patient would, for instance, look like. You have name information in this example, as well as telecom, so that would be like their work number, for example, gender, birth date, whether they're deceased or not. And then it almost works like kind of like a graph database of like managing organizations. So you can link different elements together and you can form this picture of this patient and what facility they were at and who their nurse is and all their encounters and lab reports they had. So it's a very logical way of looking at this healthcare data. So the way that we've implemented this, probably with most organizations now, we're moving to microservices. So every FHIR resource is represented by a different microservice, which is over there on the right. And then these are running on a bunch of different ports on our different servers. And then typically when you see a FHIR implementation, especially like an example, they're all pointing at the same data source. But at HCA, as well as other, I'm sure, healthcare organizations, that's just not true. Data lives in a bunch of different systems, owned and managed by different teams. And so we might have one service that's connecting to a SQL backend. We might have another that's hitting some custom code that a developer's written to pull data. We might have one that actually doesn't retrieve information, but when you post information to it, it puts it on a message queue that starts a different process that's running. And we have some that's hitting a NoSQL store, for example. So we needed a way for developers to integrate with all these different services that are running all these different ports, that are hitting all these different backend data stores in a common way with common security that we have like logging on and reporting and all that kind of stuff. So that's where the WSO2 API manager comes in. So developers now can use standard OAuth2 to integrate in. So here's a developer coming in, talking through to all of these different backend services. So there are a few things that we learned when we were implementing this. So the first is access control. So data is owned by a bunch of different groups, and we definitely don't have this solved yet, but we're working actually with WSO2 engineers on how can we really implement this. Where different groups want the ability to approve subscribers to these different APIs. And so every resource type, all those different ones that we have with those boxes, are all different APIs in our store. And then we're using the business process server to do subscription-based approval to those APIs. And we're working to see how can we integrate with these different teams to where they can approve those different people accessing those APIs. The other one is how do we pass user identity through chain services? So right now we're using the JWT token from the gateway for logging purposes on our back end, so those different services know the actual user that was requesting that healthcare data. But microservices are built in a way that they can be chained together into larger systems, and so we're trying to find a way, okay, let's take that JWT token and pass it through as it's going through these different microservices so the entire chain has an idea of the initial user that made that request. So we know if they're requesting patient information but they don't have access to location information, well, we can change that object to where they'll just receive the patient information but not the location information as a part of that. So, and then the other thing that we're working to improve as well is securing services behind the gateway. So right now we're using basic auth over SSL. We want to change that so it's going to be using mutual SSL certs between the gateway and those backend services that are running. The other thing is port management and automated deployments. So obviously, like that diagram showed, different microservices running on different ports. Our FHIR services are comprised of over 30. Our other use case I'll get to is about 45. And then as we're moving to Docker, well, Docker allows you to do automated port provisioning. So how do we integrate with WSO2 Gateway in that kind of an environment, which actually some of the talks that we've heard this morning is promising on that. We're using the admin services for the API gateway right now, integrated with TFS, Team Foundation Server from Microsoft, is our CI/CD pipeline. And so when a release happens, we're using the admin services to publish that API to the gateway and update all that information. And then the other thing that we're looking at now is using a Swagger, I think it's Swaggerbuckle or a Swashbuckle with C# to dynamically create Swagger definitions on published C# services that our gateway then can look at to pull in all that documentation into the store for those developers, just improving that DevJoy process for them. So the other problem that we did was how do we deliver healthcare data to the right people at the right time to improve patient outcomes, and how do we do it in a standard way? So elaborating on that, obviously with healthcare data, there's lots of different opportunities. So we're seeing millions of events a day across system. Those are ranging from IoT devices to labs to imaging to discharge notes, all this data that we can use to improve patient care. So that can save lives, improve processes, and improve that experience. So typically, how that's done at huge, large enterprises is teams roll their own solutions. And so especially like at HCA, where you have hundreds of different sites with hundreds of different development teams, a problem is identified, a solution is created, and it's created just for that team. And so we have all these different user experiences, all these different places where you manage notification preferences. So the goal of this was, how can we create that central hub where development teams can integrate with us and create a standard solution, not for, only for patients, but also for our practitioners and doctors, and make sure that we have doctor joy. So the other thing is around FCC requirements for text messaging, legal requirements. We need to have consent before we send messages out. Let's create a standard way where one team knows exactly how all that works so other teams don't have to worry about it. So we created the common notification platform. So this is kind of the layout. So from looking from the left, our ESB is BizTalk. It's what's receiving all healthcare events. Those are going to ingest services, which are C# microservices that our team has written, which is really kind of an extensibility point of the data before it starts entering the platform. The ingest services send that data into the DAS, which gets put onto event streams that get prosecuted by, or that get processed by execution plans that go out to other execution plans, eventually finding their way into our common notification platform and out to subscribers. So if we pictured an event, say a lab report, coming through our enterprise service bus and going into an ingest service, the ingest service processes it, and it's responsible for turning the HL7 in an XML format into an object that our DAS can understand. We then send that through to the DAS, which processes it and puts it onto obviously a ingest stream that was met for that object. So in this case, a lab report for that event. So here's where things get interesting. So we have multiple execution plans that correlate to all of our different use cases. So the one on the top, GOT, is a blood glucose use case of tracking blood glucose levels and alerting nurses at the bedside that there's an issue with the patient. And then the one on the bottom is C. diff, which is a bacterial infection that's fairly common inside hospitals. It can be life-threatening, and we want to make sure that tests are being done accurately at the right time to ensure that we can eliminate that risk for our patients. So those get processed, and then they change colors, because if an event has passed our different filters in that execution plan, it's an alertable event. So that would be, for instance, two events within 24 hours that had blood glucose levels over 500, for example, something of that nature. So we add two elements to this. We have the rule set and the rule name. So the rule set is just the use case, and the rule name is specifically what rule was triggered in that execution plan. And then here's where things get really interesting, and I'll talk about it here in a minute, but those events get picked up by dynamically created subscription execution plans, which are specific to a subscriber that cares about an alert. So if you think about 180 hospitals, well, a nurse at hospital one doesn't care about alerts for hospital two. So we need a way for them to subscribe to events and give the facility like ID or the unit name some kind of filter that correlates to what they care about. And so those events get processed through. Here's what one of those subscription execution plans look like. So we'll have a UUID at the top that corresponds to a specific person. And then you'll see down at the bottom, we have where rule name equals GOT rule one and facility code ID is 12345. So this is only going to pass if that rule is for rule one and for a facility that a subscriber cares about. So two of those go away because two of those didn't meet our criteria, they dropped. And then they're going to go through to a IBM MQ queue, which gets picked up into our CMP system, which does five things. It uses that subscription ID that was on that event to look up the person. It then determines how is this message being delivered, whether it's through email, SMS, proprietary services, secure messaging, push notifications, what have you. It then pulls a template like that on the left there, and then it replaces those placeholders with the values that came out of that DAS event, and then it sends that message through to the person. So you see there's an example of a message that's gone through. So some of the things we learn when we're doing this, one is, abstracting facility-specific data. So at the beginning when we're doing our POCs, things look like this, which is terrible. And the thing to understand is like a medication at facility one may be alertable at that facility for a rule, but that same medication at facility two may not be. It may be a different medication that they care about. And so abstracting facility data becomes extremely important. And then when you think that like healthcare systems have all these different standards, so ICD-10, SNOMED codes, medication lists, facility lists, all this information, owned by different teams again, managed by different teams, how do we keep all that updated? So FHIR luckily actually has a resource called Value Set that lets us do that. And so here's an example of a JSON object for a value set. So you can see down below that system there where it says Meditech unit 12345, that corresponds to a facility. And then we have units inside that facility. And so, like I was saying, our ingest services, those are extension points for us. And so we can have C# code like this inside those ingest services that say you're going to populate this field only if the medication that's coming on this event matches one of the ones that are in a value set, or in this example, only if the unit matches one of the units for that facility. And then our rule changes to a simple string contains inside of the string of URLs that has the unit identifier if it was a match. So that way we can keep this data over here updated by different teams, and we don't have to worry about changing rules in our DAS engine or managing complex logic of ORs, that kind of thing. So we've just abstracted that. The other thing is automatic provisioning execution plans. So this is one of those things where just because you can do it doesn't mean that you should. Originally, we needed a way to provide those subscription level filters of I only care about events if it's from this facility, that sort of thing. And so how do you do that when you have like these many events that are going to these many people? And we're like, well, the DAS engine seems to do it really well. And even for 10,000 execution plans, we haven't seen any performance impacts for that. It's mostly just when you pull up the web browser trying to load 1,000 execution plans, things can kind of move sort of slow. And so we're working on moving that kind of logic out of the DAS, allowing the DAS to do what it does really well, that state management, time windows, that sort of thing, and moving that kind of filter back into a C# service for us. So I ended really early. Actually, we can talk about testing too. So testing. When it comes to all these complex DAS rules with all these different time windows, how do you test that? So we've created C# tests using, again, the DAS admin services. They dynamically attach a test publisher to a stream that we care about. And then our C# test on release will start sending messages in and then waiting for the events to come back out and then correlating the event to the original message and ensuring it's exactly what we were expecting. The challenge for that is, though, how do you deal with time windows, for example? So if we're in dev and we have automated testing and our time window is 24 hours, well, the developers could be sitting there for 24 hours. And so our TFS release in our different environments is changing that, that time window on release for the different environments, and then we can run tests off that. The other thing we've experimented with too is you can override the timestamp going into the DAS, so we can change that timestamp for those windows as well. So now, here's an example of one of our tests that are running. So this creates a test publisher. It points it to whatever machine is running that test, and then sets up an API that's going to receive the events coming back. And now I think we're at questions. Does anyone have any questions about any of this stuff? I know I went through it really, really quickly, but I wanted to touch a bunch of stuff. Nothing? Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, so thank you for this presentation. It's incredibly insightful. Does HCA have some unique set of requirements in the sense that you have all of these different locations, you know, all over the country, and each of those different locations have different data requirements or different HL7 or FHIR requirements? And is that why, I'm a sales guy, so this is probably not a particularly well-formed question, but it seems like you're using DAS to maybe rationalize the differences across all these different locations. Is that fair to say? Something like that?
Yeah, I mean, for one, HCA acquires a lot of hospitals. And so usually when we acquire a hospital, you know, they have their own systems and stuff all set up. And we go through the process on some of moving them onto our platforms, but a few of them we leave the systems in place. So that's how we can get different versions and different things. There's also different processes are followed. So like specifically for like medication lists and stuff, you know, it's kind of up to the doctor and that sort of thing. So we have to accommodate that as well.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Anything else? Well, thank you all very much.